Tonight is an exciting night. We get to learn about love and logic with teens. I know some of you have it down pat, how to raise teens. Some of us don't. So tonight should be a good night of learning more. My name is Karen Firminger, and I work at admissions as well as the philanthropy and community engagement offices. My husband and I have 3 alumni. It's exciting to be able to still be a part of the school, working here now, and we just appreciate who Bear Creek is and what they've done for our children. At Bear Creek, what we're going to do before we get started, I want to just go through a few of the logistics. For those who are new to our upper school campus, there's restrooms right out there to the side, and then in the back there. But the most important thing is tonight you get a recording and the PowerPoint. Some of you already know that and you love that, but that means you can sit back and just relax and listen and take in it, all the notes. And what's really exciting is that you can take a deeper dive later. At the Bear Creek School, our mission is to provide a high quality Christian liberal arts education in a nurturing environment which enables each student to become the individual God intends. Having 3 alumni, we know this works. They are prepared not just for college, but for life. The other thing that my husband and I have loved about Bear Creek is the partnership. Bear Creek here is not to tell you how to parent. It's so exciting to be able to come here and actually just partner with them. In fact, tonight, our speaker here definitely is not going to be telling you how to speak, even though she has a lot of education behind her and has raised 4 kids. But she's here in a humble way as well, because she's raised 4 children and knows the challenges. So with that tone and that heart, know that tonight we're here coming alongside you, and just we hope you enjoy tonight. Well, our speaker is Karen Blankenbeckler. Many of you know her. She's been around for 30 years, and because of her, we have a wonderful academic and student life program. You'll see her education, and I've shared that she has 4 children. So with that, let's give her a warm welcome. Karen Blankebeckler.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks for being here tonight. This is so fun. I get to see lots of familiar faces now that I'm out here. So thanks for joining. This is a fun topic, talking about teenagers, and I can't wait to dive into it. Karen told you a little bit about me. I've been in education, an educational leader, and then have 4 kids. So I've been studying this thing we call teenagers for a lot of years, hundreds and hundreds of teenagers coming through the school, and then getting to have great conversations with fellow educators and parents about what works, what doesn't work, how to do this teenage thing. So it's been a lot of fun. We love teenagers. We really do. We just invest in them and want to know them more and want to know what is going to bring out the best in them and help them become those individuals that God intends. And I am not the perfect parent. I am not telling you, like, I did everything right, do it the way I did it. I learned a lot from the same way I learn a lot of things in life, from doing it wrong and doing the, ooh, I wouldn't do that way again. And then just learned a lot traveling through the years, watching other people and reading things and seeing what works. So hopefully I can share, pass some of that along. I was telling somebody, why is it that now that I'm old, I know all this stuff that I wish I would have known when my kids were younger, but I don't have the energy to go back and parent teenagers, so it's okay. I don't need to go back and do it again, but hopefully I can pass some along to you that are parenting teenagers right now, and some of this will be helpful. So we're gonna start off talking a little bit about just the basic needs of teens, and a lot of the stuff we'll talk about tonight, you all know this, but sometimes it's good just to like pull that information back up into our brains and chew on it a little bit and say, like, I know this, but how does it affect how I go about being with them each and every day? So they, just like all of us, they need to feel loved. They need to feel like they belong. And families are a big part of belonging for teenagers, to feel like those are my people, and those are my people who will be there with me no matter what. So you giving them that feeling of belonging is very important. And then they need to feel like they have some control. So we'll talk about that a little bit throughout the evening of how we can go about doing that. The teenage brain, I'm sure you've heard and read a lot about how their judgment center is not fully developed yet, right? So it is our job to actually help it develop, to help their brain be strengthened, to help them problem solve, to help them reason in that area of their brain that isn't all the way developed yet. So some of the strategies we'll talk about is actually helping that brain develop. They are more peer motivated. So let me tell you kind of how it goes. About age 5 till somewhere around age 11, they are much more adult motivated and adult focused, and they kind of do the what the adults say is good and I'm looking for approval from the adults. Right around age 11-ish, give or take with certain kids, that swings really far over to being very peer motivated. I'm looking around to see what my peers think of me. I want to know what my peers' opinions are. I want to know how my peers feel about this. And that tips all the way till about age 14. And then at about age 14, it evens out a little to be kind of a little bit in between. Like, I care what my peers think. I'm looking towards them. I want to hear their ideas on things. But they also come back to going, and trusted adults are really important in my life. What are these adults thinking about and caring about? I'm gonna look to them for guidance as well. So those are kind of the phases we see. They definitely are asking questions and seeking understanding on things and going from it's all about parents or adults to it's all mostly about peers, not all about peers, but to that evening out and I'm figuring things out from both. So these are the three principles that is gonna be the foundation of all that we talk about. And it was called love and logic. So you probably figured we're gonna talk about love and logic, but then the last principle is boundaries. So we're gonna talk through all three of those tonight and give some strategies of things that you could use to build those strong in your parents. So what is the role of a parent? I read an article, and I don't know if any of you read this, but about the role of the parent, you know, about 50 years ago. And the role of the parent about 50 years ago, parents were pretty emphatically, I don't care what hardships my kids have to go through, I don't care what trials my kids have to go to, because what matters is that they're growing in character. They're gonna be tough, they're gonna have integrity, and they're gonna endure hardships, and my role as a parent is to help them grow in character. And then we kind of came along and we became a little bit more of a safety generation. We started doing my role as a parent is to keep my kids safe. I'm worried about them. I'm thinking about the dangers that they might face, and my role is to keep them safe. And then we came a little bit further to we're kind of the experienced generation now, and my role is to make life really interesting and fun and exciting for my kids, and they shouldn't be bored, and they should be happy most of the time, and my role as a parent is to make sure that happens. So we're gonna talk about what your tendencies might be, but we're also gonna ground ourselves a little bit in what we are actually trying to do as parents, and I think you guys will agree with these things. We really are trying to help our kids be people of virtue, right? I think I haven't heard of a parent who wouldn't agree with that. I want my child to be a person of character, both now and into the future. I want my child to become a happy adult, and to become a happy adult, they might not be happy every moment of their teenage years, right? Because we do have to go through some things and learn some things and be resilient through some things. And then we want to help our team learn to love God more and to love others more. So as we're working through this stuff, think about that's the kind of person that we're shaping as we use some of these tools. So we're going to talk about four different parenting styles. And the first one is, it's historically been called the helicopter parent, but I couldn't resist kind of doing slash drone parrot, because I think that's a little more in our modern, like, you know, kind of I fly in, I hover a little, I sneak back out. I think that's the helicopter drone parrot. Permissive or friend parent, and then the drill sergeant parent, and the consultant guide parent. So none of you are all one of these things. You just might see, oh, I have some tendencies in that direction. So as I describe them, just kind of self-identify, I think I have some of those tendencies to be that kind of parent. So we'll talk about the helicopter drone parent first. And that parent is often, not always, but often motivated by fear. They really are thinking about their teenager's safety a lot. And they're making decisions of when to step in and when to step out. A lot of decisions based on fear and keeping their child safe. The implied message they give to their child is, you need me to protect you and rescue you. So probably not the message most of us were hoping to send, but that message can be sent with the helicopter or drone parent. The next one is the permissive or friend parent, and it's pretty closely related to the helicopter or drone parent, but really the motivation is, I really want you to like me. And of course, there's nothing wrong with wanting to have a strong relationship with our teenagers. You hear people say, my daughter's my best friend. That's not a bad thing if it means like we have this close relationship. What we're trying to avoid is, I need you to call me a friend, and I am going to make decisions based on wanting you to like me in all my decisions. So that's what we're kind of looking for. Your role isn't, I need to keep you happy at every moment, and I need you to be happy with me at every moment. The implied message when we did that is, you don't know how to handle your own difficulties, somebody else will fix it. So that's that one. I found this cute little cartoon, and I don't know if you guys can even read it, and I'm gonna have to step close to read it. I couldn't get it any bigger on a slide, but I thought it kind of captured what we were just talking about with, in the 1980s, so this is the mom saying to her daughter, Sarah, your teacher tells me you were misbehaving in school today. Tonight, you'll do the dishes, and tomorrow, you'll apologize to her. No excuses. Daughter says, okay, sorry, Mama. In 2018, Princess, your teacher left a message on the phone. What does she want? Oh, she's stupid. She thinks I don't pay any attention. Mom says, well, that's ridiculous. Don't worry, I'll text her and take care of it for you. So that would be kind of somewhere in the helicopter parent or the friend parent. Drill sergeant parent is that parent that sounds angry, even when they aren't. They tend to issue demands or orders. They're the parent who would say, because I said so. Have any of you ever said that? I know we make fun of our parents for saying that, but we might fall into that trap sometimes as the drill sergeant parent. And the implied message is, you need others to tell you what to do. You can't figure it out yourself. So that's that one. The last, oh, I thought this was hilarious. A large part of being a mom is staring at your kids like this until they act better. do any of you have that look? Yeah, it's a good one. We all have our look, and it's okay to have the look, because sometimes our kids just need a little nudge of what you're doing. It's not okay. But so the last one is kind of the love and logic approach, and that's the consultant or guide parent. And this type of parenting would be active listening, giving your kids options and suggestions, giving them choice whenever possible, helping them solve their own problems. And so when we say consultant or guide, it doesn't mean you don't ever say, I'm making this decision for you. They are still teenagers, they are not adults yet, and they do need you as parents. So when we say consult and guide, it isn't a just we're buddies and you can decide, but it's helping them make choices and solve their own problems. So we'll talk through some of those. No matter which of these you tend towards, and did most of you kind of relate a little bit to one or the other of those? These are the principles we're going to keep focusing on tonight, no matter which you are, and that's the love, logic, and boundaries. And so the first one we're going to talk about is the love part of love and logic. And I said early on, one of the core needs of teenagers is to know they're loved. And I just want to start off by saying, say it often. Don't just assume they know I love them. Of course I love them. I'm their dad. Of course I love them. Say it to them. They need to hear it a lot, especially in those teenage years when things are a little uncertain. So saying things like, especially when they make a mistake or something hard happens or they mess up, I love you no matter what you do or say. Say phrases like that. Here's another phrase. I am making this decision because I love you and I want what's best for you. We disagree. So this one, have you guys ever disagreed with your teenager? And sometimes that disagreement feels terrible, doesn't it? And maybe we are just disagreeing. Using this, we disagree, and I may be wrong. I was always amazed how my kids' countenance switched when I said that. You know what? I'm not perfect. I'm doing the best I can to parent you with the knowledge and the wisdom that God's given me. That doesn't mean I'm going to make every decision correct, but even if I may be wrong, I have to parent you with what I think is best because I love you too much not to. And so letting them just know that my decisions I'm making for you are out of love for you, and say that explicitly to them. Part of loving on them is building up their self-concept of who they are. And building up self-concept isn't just about using fluffy words like, you're so great, you're so pretty, you're so smart. As a matter of fact, those words aren't incredibly helpful. But looking to affirm gifts that you see in them that were given by God, because God gives us good gifts, right? And he gives us those gifts to be used. And when you see those in your kids, point those out. Point out the, like, wow, you have a gift of encouraging other people. I see you use that gift a lot, and I can't wait to see more of that gift and what you're going to do with that gift. Wow, you have the gift of problem solving. I see you encounter things, and you're able to figure out what to do about it. That's an amazing gift. I love that gift. It could even be in a academic subject area, like, wow, you have a gift for writing, for using words, for weaving those words together to tell something. That's a really great gift that God has given you. I can't wait to see how you might use that gift. So affirm those kinds of things, and then praise other things that they can control, right? The gifts that God gave them, you're seeing them and you're just encouraging them to use them. But then other things that they can control how they're growing in character and their effort. So we want to praise those things that we see. And then last, we just always want to be sending the message to teenagers that you are capable. It's super important in those years. I would say especially boys, they're trying to figure out how capable they are. It's true of boys and girls, but especially boys. If boys are getting messages, I'm not capable, it really shuts them down and they have a harder time learning and growing. So send those messages. And then things that may damage their self-concept and make them struggle feeling love is excessive criticism. And again, when you do it, you're probably doing it because you love them and you're trying to give them feedback and you're trying to tell them what was wrong, but excessive criticism will beat them down and have them feel not as loved. Overprotection or overindulgence, comparing to others, especially tough if you're comparing them to their siblings, and then perfectionism, which comes across as conditional love, and we want to send them, I love you no matter what you do or say. So make sure we're doing those things. What love does not mean is let them do whatever they want so you don't disappoint them, right? That's not real love. That's That's more about like safety of, I want to make sure you like me. And it can be a little bit more about what we need than what they need, right? We need to be willing to do the tough things sometimes that they need. Spare them from any hardship. I'm going to fix everything. That's not what love really is, because we know sparing them from every hardship isn't actually helping them learn and grow. And then making sure every moment of every day is fun. My sister used to call me, we have our middle children are just a year apart, and she used to call me and say, I drug them all to the automotive place and they're just sitting there bored. You told me it's okay for them to be bored, right? It's okay for them to be bored. And I would say, guess what happens when kids don't have just ready-made entertainment? They have to play games, they have to think, they have to tell stories. So yes, let them be bored sometimes, because that's when your imagination comes out. So we want to make sure we don't feel like every moment of every day has to be wonderful, or we've not done a good job parenting. So if I had one thing to do over again with my teenagers, this is the one thing I would try to do better, and that's to ask questions and listen more. I tended to be a little bit more in that, let me tell you what you should do, let me tell you how you should think, let me give you a little lecture on what that ought to be and why you ought to do that and why that's a good idea. I wish I would have done way less talking and way more listening and just being super careful that I was asking a good question. That listening, if it comes with eye contact and empathy and touch, is really, really powerful with teenagers. So I am going to invite my friend and colleague, Jen McDonough, we're gonna be, let's see, on this first one, Jen's gonna take a seat and be our teenager. And I am going to be the parent. And we're gonna do one, and this is about listening. And we're gonna do one that is a model of what not to do first. So just imagine we're here having this conversation, and Jen's my daughter. Hi, daughter.
Hello, Mom. I do not understand why parents make such a big deal about social media.
Because it's bad for you.
It's no big deal. It's just the way we socialize. Parents don't understand.
Oh, I understand just fine. It's bad for you, and you are not going to be allowed, period.
You're so unfair. All my friends are on it, and without it, I'm completely left out.
Well, and this is the time lecture kicks in, if you have my personality. Well, let me tell you, social media is terrible for you for many reasons. It distracts you from your schoolwork, kids are bullied on social media, kids don't make good choices on social media. If I let you have social media, all those things might happen.
You just don't understand.
I said no. Okay, now we're gonna do, like, give it a try again, same conversation, and the way that conversation might look and feel a little different.
I don't know why parents make such a big deal about social media.
Tell me more.
I mean, it's not a big deal. It's just the way we socialize. Parents just don't understand.
What do you wish I understood?
We talk about things, and we see what friends are doing. If you're not on social media, you miss out on everything.
What does it feel like to miss out on things?
Well, it's sad. Like maybe you don't have as many friends.
That sounds hard. Why do you think parents have concerns about social media?
I don't know.
I'm sorry that it's hard. Let me know if you want to talk more about the reasons. Okay, so I'm going to ask Jen a couple questions, and just even though this is make-believe and she's not really a teenager, what did you feel different in those two scenarios?
Well, Karen is the author of these scenarios, and so when I read them out loud, I actually softened on the second one. I mean, I'm not a teenager, not even close, and I just softened, like, it made me feel warm and fuzzy. I don't mean to sound cheesy, but really, it did. I felt like maybe you're listening.
How did the first one make you feel?
I was ready to fight you. Well, let's go right now. I'm going to win, too, because you didn't give me anything. I'm just going to win and just be stubborn and obstinate.
Yeah, so did the outcome change from one to the other? No, outcome's still the same, but did the conversation and the feel and the way we're treating each other change? Absolutely. And your teenagers do tactics to kind of get you elevated and to try to kind of go, I'm going to come at you like this, and I'm coming at, you know, some of those, you're mean, right? They're trying to get that, and they're expressing their own emotions, and they're trying to get those emotions back out of you. So if at all possible, just staying in that calm and asking questions. So we use a little model at school that we use when having a more difficult conversation that involves maybe something emotional. And we call it CLAD. It's a little catchy, and the C for CLAD stands for commit to caring for that person first. And it's amazing how this transforms. And I hope you guys will, I hope you'll take this and it will stick with you because it's super simple, right? C-L-A-D. But when you do the, oh, wow, this is a heated conversation. Oh, wow, this person's really upset. Oh, wow, they're angry. If you can just do the, oh, there's that CLAD thing. The first one is commit to caring for that person. And committing to caring that for that person can be about your body language. It can be that next word that you say. You can literally say, I care about you. Tell me more about what's going on. It makes such a difference. Something in our humanness, when somebody comes at us like this, we want to come back at them like this. But if we could, if you could just do that, like, care first. They're coming at me like this. What statement might I be able to make next that's caring? The next part of it, listen. Just stay calm, care, and listen, and then ask some questions. Tell me more about that. Tell me what's drawn you to think that. Tell me what you're talking about with your friends. I'd like to hear more about that. And then last, you can determine, after you've done all those steps and things kind of have gotten a little more calm, then you can determine what is my role in this and what do I need to do next. And you're just calmed it all down and you're now in much more of a thinking place to handle it. So that's CLAD. I hope you take that with you, and I hope you remember that because it's really helpful. All right, so those were all of our strategies in our first category, which was love. And now we're going to do some things with logic, which is letting them experience consequences of their choices. And giving them choices is a main thing in that. So this is my situation. I forgot my binder, and Jen's not going to help me with this one. I'm just going to do it. So it happens. I mean, replace binder for, I forgot my flute, I forgot my computer, I forgot my, but you pull up in front of the school and I forgot my binder, right? Has anything like this ever happened to you? So here's where we want to think through, like, which type of teen is living with you? The teen who rarely forgets anything, and when they do forget it, anxiety goes up, stress goes up, because they hardly ever forget anything. They get things right, and now I forgot my binder. So that's one scenario, right? And what do we want to do for that? What do we want to do for that teen? We want to meet their needs, probably a little bit of CLAD. Wow, that's really hard when you forget your binder, isn't it? Probably don't have time to go through all the listen and ask a bunch of questions because you just pulled up in front of the school. But starting with a little care there, and then what can I do to support you? What could we do at this place because you forgot your binder? It could look like a lot of different things, right? It could look like, well, do you think if you told your first period teacher that you forgot your binder, they might be able to help you out? Could it look like that? Helping them realize it's not the end of the world. My stress doesn't have to tip over. I've got some tools of how I can handle this. It could literally look like, hey, you never forget stuff. We all need help sometimes when we forget stuff. Would you want like me to run home and go grab it and bring it back? For teen number one, that might be the best message for them, that we help each other when things are tough, and you don't usually forget your binder. Teen number two, maybe a different story, occasionally forgets, and when this teen forgets, they think it's no big deal. No big deal. Forgot my binder. What do you want to do with this one? Probably want them to face some natural consequences of that own choice, right? Like, what's going to happen if you forgot your binder? Oh, bummer. You're not going to be able to turn that in. Oh, bummer. Probably will mean you have extra homework tonight because you didn't get done what you needed to get done in class. Oh, bummer. It might mean you have to miss that thing you were hoping to do tonight because forgotten binder means didn't get work done, which means you need to do it when you get home tonight. Bummer. They probably need a little lesson in when I forget things and think it's no big deal. I do need to face the consequences of my own forgetting things. Last one, forgets things all the time and wants people to solve it for you. This is the hard one because they are usually masters at, but could you help me out? But could you grab it for me? They're also masters at like doing it with their friends too. Hey, can I just borrow yours? Could I look off of yours for the day? Okay, there's a little bit of like, good job, you know how to solve problems, but a little bit of, we want to make sure we're not rescuing them, we're not solving it for them, and they're figuring out that forgetting things has consequences, and we're gonna go ahead and let them have the consequences for what they did. So here's another similar, but a little bit different. I forgot my lunch. This one's a little bit different because the natural consequence might be different for each kid, right? Like, I think there probably are some of you who would go, oh, well, they get to find out what life's like to be a little bit hungry, right? Could that be a reasonable choice for some kids? Sure, I actually had a mom who did it after she went to one of my sessions. She came up to me and said, I want you to know, my daughter forgot her lunch and I made her just go hungry, and she was so proud. And I was like, oh, okay, well, that might have been a good choice. Natural consequence, she went a little hungry. For some kids, is that a good choice? Probably not. They may not be able to function well the rest of the day, or they may have health issues that it'd be really not good for them to miss a lunch. So with kids like that, we're going to do more of like, what are you going to do to solve that problem? What are you going to do to take care of it? We're going to try to avoid rescuing them and being the answer for it every time, and get them to solve it. If we do need to go, okay, for this time, I'm going to go get your lunch, but here's what the trade-off is going to be. You're going to do something for me because I got your lunch for you, or you need to solve this problem this way and do a trade-off. Try to avoid making it like, of course, I'll go rescue you. I'll go get that because you have no other choice. And just kind of work with them on that. So those are a little trickier and they take a little bit more weighing out of what should we do. But the goal is, so we're gonna avoid rescuing. We're gonna realize that sometimes short-term pain, literally one afternoon of being a little bit hungry, is not going to kill them. And we are trying to avoid long-term problems like, I just don't care about being responsible for my stuff. But this is the thing I was trying to say. You have to decide which action. Remember that outcome of who we're trying to have our kids become? Which action is going to help them grow in virtue? Which action is going to help them be a happy adult later, because they might have a lesson to learn right here, right now, even if the lesson's not fun? And which lesson will help them realize that they are loved? So we're kind of working those through and thinking about your child and which thing is going to most help them grow is how you make those kinds of decisions. So another strategy that is really helpful, you probably did this a lot when your kids are little, is you gave them control and you gave them choices, right? Guess what? Teenagers need that too, and we sometimes forget to use it. When they were little, you would go, oh, do you want to wear your blue pants or your green pants, right? Do you want to go up the slide this way or up that way? And we were trying to avoid tantrums or battles or those things that you do with little kids, but teenagers need the same thing. They need control. They need for you to give them some control. If we control too much, they will be really frustrated and they won't learn to be in control. So choices like, would you rather wash your car this morning or this afternoon, work a lot better than, okay, you're up, within the next 20 minutes, I need you out there washing your car. What are you gonna get if you do that? Within 20 minutes, I need you out there washing your car. We just dominated them, right? We just took control over anything they might have had planned for the day or anything they were thinking about it, and we said, our agenda matters and you do it now. There may be times we have to say that, but for the most part, we want to avoid that. We want to go, you probably had a day planned. You probably had things you were thinking you were going to do, so you choose. It needs to be done today, but it could be done this morning or this afternoon, which one works better for you? So just honoring them, which one feels best for you. Feel free to do this or do this. It has to be done, but you choose. Choices are really important for teenagers. So here's a strategy that I really like. I can't say I used it effectively with my kids, but I think it's a really good one. So if you guys get good at it, maybe you'll figure out how to use it, but I think it's pretty clever, and I think it could work really well. So the strategy is tell them what you will do instead of what they have to do. So it could look like this. Dad says, I will drive you to practice after you clean your room. Teen says, I don't care if my room is messy. Dad says, no problem. What? What does that mean? I guess it won't be a problem for me. Teen says, what does that mean? Are you taking me to practice or not? I will drive you to practice after you clean your room. And then that would be a really good time to walk away. And what does that leave them with? Pretty hard to... They're kind of left there with, huh, I guess if I want to be driven to practice, I need to clean my room, right? And so they may go, I'm not cleaning my room and I'm not going to practice. So don't use this if you don't really mean it. But if you're okay that they're going to, I'm not cleaning my room, I'm not going to practice, and they would learn a really valuable long-term lesson by a short-term pain thing, probably worth it. Most kids won't do that, though. Most kids will go, okay, I guess I shouldn't. I guess I'll go up and clean my room because I really want to go to practice. So that strategy can be really effective depending upon your teen's personality. All right, so we've done love. We've done logic. We're going to talk a little bit about boundaries. So boundaries is the last one. Teenagers do need boundaries to feel safe. They are not grown-ups yet. We cannot just go, okay, well, do whatever you want. You decide, your choice. We are still the parents, and we still need to give them boundaries. So when we set boundaries, we should, again, express love. I am on your side. I care about you. These rules that we have in our house are for your good. They are because I care about you. That's why we have rules. And if you choose not to follow the rules, there are consequences for these rules, because same reason, we give consequences because I need you to learn to follow these rules. And sometimes consequences are the way you learn. I'd rather not have to give you consequences, but I need you to learn to follow these things. So if I need to give consequences for you to learn, then we need to give consequences. Saying no. How many of you are, we don't have to raise your hand, but just think, how many of you are quick no people, and how many of you are, I hardly ever say no, and then some of you are probably right in the middle. My husband is a quick to say no person. It's the first thing out of his mouth. You just go. And no, because he just hasn't had time to think about it. It's kind of bugging him. He doesn't feel great about it. So his first response is no. So I've experienced that. But general principle, say no as infrequently as you can, but say it if you need to. Sometimes we as the adults need to say no. But if you don't have to say no, and you can still accomplish all those things in their life that you hope to accomplish, don't. If you need to, saying, I need some time to think about that is much better than a quick no. Because if you say no, you better mean it. Because what happens if we say no and they know they can talk us out of the no? What happens? They're going to try to talk you out of every time you say no. So there's a little balance there between we don't want to say no a lot. If we're not sure and we think we might even consider it, don't say no yet. Say, let me think about that for a little bit. Let me weigh that out. I want to think that through. And then when we really need to say no, the no needs to be the no. No, I've made up my mind. It's a no. All right, so Jen's going to come back out and help me with a we need to say no scenario. And she's the teenager again. She always gets to be the teenager.
Hey, Mom, a bunch of kids are going to go stay the night at Joe's after the soccer game. Can I go?
No, you're not doing that.
Why?
Because I said so.
Everyone is going.
That doesn't mean you're going.
You are so mean.
I am the parent. I make the rules.
I hate you.
I hate you is a power thing that teenagers like to use because it creates this response. Do you remember when your kids were little and they would say, "You're not invited to my birthday party," to their friends? That was a power thing. They're trying to get power. I hate you is a power thing with teenagers. So just be ready for it. If they haven't said it yet, they might. They don't really hate you. All right, same scenario with love and logic.
Hey, Mom, a bunch of kids are going to stay the night at Joe's after the soccer game. Can I go?
I'm not comfortable with the level of supervision at Joe's. Let me check into that a little bit, and I'll answer you a little later. So, some time went by, conversation comes up again. I know this is going to be disappointing, but I don't think staying the night at Joe's is a good decision, so I'm going to have to say no.
But everyone's going.
I bet that's disappointing.
You're so mean.
Why do you think I said no?
Because you hate me.
Do you really think I hate you?
No, not really.
I know it's disappointing. I love you and I want what's best for you. What do you think you might be able to do instead? All right, how'd you feel, Jen? Oh. How mad were you at me?
I love what you said, that there's things that can provoke, but you not provoking back, super helpful. You just stay calm. Just be calm.
All right, thank you, Jen. Can you guys give a round of applause to my Jen? She's awesome. So I hope that helped you a little bit with how that conversation might be able to go. Still, you're still saying no because you don't think it's a good idea. You've weighed it out. You've determined. I don't think that's best for you. But the way we do that exchange with using love, using statements that help them understand, and listening, trying to understand where they're coming from, and showing them empathy as we do it. It is super disappointing when your kid really wants to do something and we say no, right? Super disappointing. It's one of the hardest things to do as a parent. And we have a few choices. We can be the drill sergeant parent. We can say, you're not going. We can be the friend parent and let them go anyway, even though we think it's a really bad idea, but we don't want them to be mad at us or be disappointed. Or we stand in the middle and we try to do the I love you so much and I'm making this decision because it's what I think is best for you. And those are hard shoes to stand in, but I would challenge you and encourage you to try to stand in those shoes, and your kids will respond. They, even when they disagree and even when they're disappointed, when you show them that love and care and tell them that you're doing it because you care about them, they'll be sad for a while, but they will understand. All right, dealing with teens when you're angry. This one's a hard one, right? Because when they do the, I hate you, or that's not fair, or you know, in some of us that anger comes up, right? So don't make extreme statements you can't follow through with. We've all been in the park when the mom says that's it, we're never coming to the park again. Really, you're never going to a park again. Really. So don't say things you don't mean. Don't say extreme statements, and don't give ultimatums. Here's one principle: if it is an emergency, give yourself think time. Consult with others. If I'm angry right now, we don't make our best decisions when we're angry. Let's talk in a little while. Is a really great one to hold on to. None of us make our best decisions when we're angry, and admitting, this conversation has made me angry. I think we need to put a little stop in it, and I think we need to take this up later when we're doing our better thinking. Feel free to use that anytime that you're feeling angry, and they'll let it go too. They're not doing their best thinking either, because often it's them angry, you angry, and it's going from there. So taking a little pause, taking a little break, and going, let's both think a little bit before we talk more about this. Principle number two, the angrier you feel, the quieter your voice should get. This is a teacher trick. Actually, we capture people's attention better when we talk like this than when we yell. When we yell, people shut down. They can't hear, their defenses kick in, they shut out. It's almost like they can't hear anything you're saying. So if you're feeling super angry, if you can bring it down to the quietest voice that is comfortable for you, it immediately calms things and makes us be able to hear each other. So just a little strategy that can be really, really helpful when you're feeling yourself angry. All right, so we've done our love, we've done our logic, and we've done our boundaries. I hope that you can take some of these tools with you. We'll send out the slideshow and you can look back at them, and maybe one of them resonates with you, and you can go, oh, that clad thing, I'm gonna try that. Oh, the how to say no and show love, I'm gonna try that. Choices, I'm gonna try that. So I'm hoping that from what you heard tonight, some of these ideas will stick and that you can use them with your children. Very last slide, this is from the Love and Logic book, and I love this quote. Effective parenting centers around love. Love that is not permissive, love that doesn't tolerate disrespect, but also love that is powerful enough to allow kids to make mistakes and permit them to live with the consequences of those mistakes. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you, Karen, so much for coming. Appreciate you. I think we have some principles to take home in marriages too, but that's another topic for another night. Karen, you can go ahead and go out front. Karen's gonna stay for a while out front if you have any questions or if you have any comments with her. So she'll go get settled, and I'll just go through a couple slides. We're gonna be sending you this PowerPoint, so there's just some resources. So it's Parenting with Teens and Logic. And many of you know at Bear Creek, we've had a lot of faculty speak on parenting with love and logic, just for the younger kids. So this looks great resources. Also for access, it's free, it's online. Our school actually was one of the helping partners, I guess, to get this organization going. Now it's free to everyone. So I definitely think that you need to check this out as for those conversation starters and to try to get the kids to speak and share every topic and topics you don't even understand and know about, because they're always ahead of you, the different apps and such. So I highly recommend this. Also, Common Sense Media is a wonderful resource as well for just understanding, really, in the teen world. You just trying to be one step ahead of them is so hard. So here's some resources for you. If you are an educator, welcome, welcome. We need you for sure. Everyone's going to get the PowerPoint and the survey. We would love your input. But educators, to receive your CE hours, you definitely have to do a survey. And also, you know about the tools for success. You're here tonight, so we have another one coming up in January, and then another one in February. It's going to be awesome content as well. And just so you know, you're more than welcome to bring your friends and coworkers to these events. And finally, admissions for those who are new to Bear Creek or are interested. We have a wonderful admissions website. Go check things out. We have admissions table out front. One thing that's really important for you, we're so blessed by our community, and as we've grown, we have amazing scholarships and grandparents and endowments. So when you look at the sticker price, don't be shocked, because God will take care of you, and we have some wonderful resources. So definitely check that out as well, and tell your friends and neighbors as well. And that's it for tonight, and just thank you so much for coming. I hope it was a good night, and I'm already going to try to start talking softer in conversations. So that's what I'm leaving with. I wasn't able to pray at the beginning. I forgot. So I would love to close this in a word of prayer. Father God, just thank you so much for this time, and just how you partner with us and guide us. Thank you for the grace that you give to us in our parenting, and help us to have grace for our children. Thank you so much for Karen Blankenbeckler and Jen. They've had long days, and just to share their wealth of information, and I'm just grateful for them. Go with us now, Lord, in thy precious name. Amen. Have a good night, everyone. Thank you.